Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for today. We know you're already in our midst. Holy Spirit, entirely, our hearing faculty, my mouth, have your way. Do what only you can do, just like my pastor prayed. And you take all the glory and all the honor. For in Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
Right. Without much of ado, I want us to open our Bibles to two readings to start with. The Gospel according to St. John. I'm going to read from verse 1 to verse 9. And then we're going to go to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, and we're going to read one verse from there. I hope you all have our Bibles, but just in case you don't, it's on the screen. Alright, I read. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him, that is the Word, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. Verse 4. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. Note verse 5. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. A man who was sent from God, his name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all men might believe. He himself was not the light. He only came as a witness to the light. Verse 9. The true light that gives light to every man was coming into the world. Matthew chapter 5. I'm going to read just two verses, verse 14 and 15. And probably 16. You are the light of the world, a city on a hill that cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, it is put on its stand and gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and praise your heavenly Father. Ladies and gentlemen, the two passages that we have read. Okay. The first passage that we read said, in the beginning was the Word.
Yeah.
And it began to tell us something that it's mysterious. Came out like a riddle. It says the Word was with God, and this same Word was also God.
Yeah.
Wow. But he now said to us that this Word that we're talking about is a person.
Yeah.
It's a person. And in him, in that person, there is life. And that life is the light of man. And then, if you read further, we didn't particularly read that scripture, in verse 14, he now said to us in John chapter 1, verse 14, he says, this word now became flesh and dwelt among us. But he also gave us an insight into this light and the kind of power that this light has. He says, this light shines in darkness. And darkness does not understand it. This light what? Shines in darkness, and darkness does not comprehend it. This light shines in darkness, and darkness cannot overcome it. Yes. This light shines.
Amen.
And Lisa told us that this light became flesh and dwelt among us. And in the book of Matthew that we read, he now said, look, this you and I are the light of the world.
Yes.
Yeah. And if we are the light of the world, then that placed on a hill that cannot be hidden. He says, you do not put a lamp, put on the lamp, and then hide it. You put it on a stand. And it has a function. It has a purpose. And the purpose of that light is to give light to everyone in the house.
Yes.
It now began to explain to us, how does our light shine? What does he really mean? He says, the evidence that you, your light, my light is shining is according to the good deeds that we do. In him was life. That life was the light of man. The light shines in darkness, and darkness has not understood it. He is the true light.
Yeah.
If he says the true light, ladies and gentlemen, that means there is a false light.
Mm-hmm.
If there is a true light, that means there is a false light. The Bible emphasized the fact that it's not just the light, but it's the, that means the only one, and the true light.
Yeah. Amen.
You and I need to be careful in the days and the seasons that we live in. In the days and the seasons that we live in, they are false light. The Bible says that the devil disguises as the angel of light. He masquerades himself. He comes as if he is the light, but he's not the light. In the days and the seasons that we live in, ladies and gentlemen, we have what we call a covered light. Shaded light. You know what a shaded light is? When you give someone an half-truth. If you come to Jesus, your problem is solved.
Yeah.
When you come to Jesus, you will never have any problem.
Yeah.
They will sing a song that says that I will not suffer because Jesus has suffered. He looks good. Are you with me?
Yeah.
It's what? It sounds good, it looks good, but it is not the truth. God does not want you to suffer. Yes. Would you suffer? Yes. Huh?
Yes.
Singing a song that to say to someone, telling somebody that you come to Christ, you will not suffer. You come to Christ, you are not suffering. Or when something bad happens to you, then you are considered to be a sinner.
Yeah.
Or when something bad, something tragic happens to you, then that means you happen to be, there's something wrong with you. You don't know how to pray. You have not prayed enough. You are labeled.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Instead of people to love you, they resent you. They put a stigma. Ladies and gentlemen, Jesus Christ is the true light.
Yes.
Yeah.
And this Jesus Christ said we are the light.
Yeah.
How come we are the light? Because he became flesh. And through his blood, we have the life of Jesus. Leviticus chapter 17, verse 11 says to us, I'm not going to open it. It says, the life of a creature is in his blood.
Yeah.
The reason why you and I had the light is because of the blood that Jesus Christ shed. Because the life of Jesus is in the blood.
Yeah.
Are you with me? So he had to die on the cross. He had to suffer that. Why? So that you and I can be that light. So that his blood can be shed. The Bible says in John chapter 3 verse 16, it says, for God so loved the world. How did he demonstrate that love? That his only begotten Son, to whom and in whom all creation was created, died on the cross.
Yeah.
So that through his death and the blood that is shed on the cross, are you with me? We have the life of Christ. We have his righteousness. We have access to the Father. We are equal to him. Why? Because the blood that was shed. And therefore, that makes us the light. Do we understand on the same level?
Yes.
Praise God. all this mean? It means God, we are God's solution. In John chapter 1, verse 9, it says, the true light has come to the world for every man. Now, Jesus Christ is no longer here. Yeah. There are some people that have not seen the light. So what's God's solution? It's you and I. He has no other plan.
Yeah.
There is no plan B. Ladies and gentlemen, the problem is not the darkness. The problem is the fact that the light is not shining. Are you with me? Every time you Christians, we Christians, are complaining about the doom and the darkness and the things that are happening that we are not happy with, that we think is evil. I'll say, oh, the death of the world is coming down. I can't wait for me to go to heaven. You are wasting your time. You have the solution. Yeah. You are the problem.
Yeah.
The fact that you are not shining is the problem. The problem is never with the darkness. The problem is with the light. The reason God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah is not because of the sins of Sodom and Gomorrah. It is because there was no 10 righteous people there. Are you with me? Because Abraham knew that, hold on, God, you are a loving God, you are a caring God. You will not destroy the righteous with the unrighteous. Okay, let there be 50. And I said, just in case my brother, he's forgotten his evangelistic skills. And I began to reduce it. Now, if you find 10 people there, would you destroy the city? God said, no. If I can find these 10 people, I will not destroy. He got there, he couldn't find 10 people. Therefore, he destroyed. If he had found 10 people, he would have. So, what was the real problem? Was it Sodom and Gomorrah? Or the fact that there were few righteous people in the land? When the light does not shine, then darkness takes over. Ladies and gentlemen, the solution to the world is you and I. Jesus Christ says, you and I are the light of the world.
Amen.
No matter how dark a room may be, the moment light appears, guess what happens to the darkness? It moves back. When you turn off the light, it comes back on again. Are you with me?
Yeah.
So the activity, we are the ones that determine the activity that happens around us. Either our action or our inaction. We are meant to shine. We are meant to be displayed. We are meant to be shown off by God. And the evidence, ladies and gentlemen, like I said earlier on, is in our good works, in our good deeds. But note, guys, my brothers and sisters, there is a price to pay. There is a process that you and I need to go through for us to really shine. Give me an example of someone in the Bible. His name is Joseph, a foreigner.
Yeah.
With no papers. Came into the country as a slave.
Yeah.
But later became the prime minister. In the homes of the gods. All the demons on earth in those days lived in Egypt. There were various gods there. Yet, God was able to bring Joseph in and made him the prime minister.
Yeah.
Do you see that? Darkness cannot comprehend it.
Yeah.
How do you explain it? Jesus Christ, the Son of God, came out of Egypt.
Yeah.
Oh, how do you explain it? Pharaoh made a decision that I'm going to destroy all these people, all these Egyptians, destroy all their children, and yet, in his palace, Moses was raised.
Yes.
Are you with me?
Yeah.
When the light shines, darkness cannot comprehend it. It cannot overcome it. It is the same Pharaoh, the same Moses, the same Pharaoh that passed the decree. In his house, Moses was raised.
That's right. Yeah.
And that Moses that was raised in his house came out again to deliver the people and destroy even the firstborn of that Pharaoh himself.
Yeah, that's right.
The problem is not the darkness. The problem is the fact that the light is not shining. And the problem is not because Jesus Christ is not that. It's the problem that you and I are not shining.
Yeah.
Yes.
Help us,
yes.
Listen to me before you start. I didn't judge you. I said you and I. Mm-hmm. Now you're including myself.
Help us,
Lord. But listen to me. From the beginning of this year, we began to deal with aspire to inspire.
Yeah.
Later, we added before we expire.
Yeah.
So let us know there's a sex of urgency in there.
Yes.
Yeah.
to know that there's a sense of what? Urgency. Not concerning Joseph, you know what the Bible says? It says, all the world came to Egypt to buy grain from Joseph.
Yeah.
Can you imagine how light, the light of Joseph, how much, how it shined?
Yeah.
The whole world came to him to buy.
Yeah.
He controlled the price of commodity. He was the most influential man in the world.
Yeah.
In the world.
That's right.
In the land where there are more idols than anywhere else.
Yeah.
The only one ceremonially that was higher than him was Pharaoh.
Yeah.
But the Bible says that he, God has made him, Joseph said, God has made me a father even to Pharaoh himself.
Yes.
That means I determine what Pharaoh does. Pharaoh consults me.
Yes.
Yeah.
But the church today is complaining about the government instead of the church advising the government. We are busybody criticizing everything when we are supposed to be the solution, are hiding away, are shying away, come up with one excuse or the other, not knowing that the light that we carry, the blood was shed. With God, ladies and gentlemen, all things are possible.
Amen.
There is no hindrance. You are the light, there's no hindrance. There's nothing that's stopping you from shining because you are the light. Jesus made you the light. The moment you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you have become the light of the world. You are meant to stand on a stand and give light to your house. Where is that house? Your place of work. Where is that house? Your family that you came from. Where is that? The community that you live in.
Yes.
Where is that light? The career that you are doing.
That's right.
The best physician should be a Christian.
Yeah.
The best researcher should be a Christian. Yeah. The Bible says in Deuteronomy chapter 29, verse 29, it says, the secret thing belongs unto God.
Yeah.
The hidden things belongs unto those he has revealed it to. So therefore, if you are looking for the answer to solving cancer, we Christians are the solution to that.
Yes.
Are you with me?
Yes.
Are you with me? Joseph, in his days, the whole world came to him to buy. And if he says today, I'm not selling, he says this is the price, that's the price. One man. There's a process. How did he start? He was a young man, I think about the age of 70. He was loved by his father. He was given a special coat by his father to demonstrate his love. But he had a dream.
Yeah.
To be great from a very young age. Listen, gentlemen, for us parents here, how are we raising our children? Our parents may have made mistakes or not. We can complain that my brother did not do this. Okay. Now, even I'm grandfather, I can imagine. We need to instill in our children that they're great and they're meant to be great.
Amen.
You know, like most of us, by looking at our faces, we originate from Africa. In Africa, they only know one language. Fight. That's the language of parenthood. And you are the beauty of love. I can't understand how you can say you are loving me and you are beating me. Indiscriminately. And you tell me that's love, but God forgive them. All of you have forgiven your parents and beat you. I know the funny thing again, you know, we grow up and we now say, ah, thank God that they disagree with me. Are you sure? Are you really sure? I'm not thank God that my father beat me. But when he beat me, I doubted his love. There were times in my days I wish he won't come back for me, just die. Thank God God did not answer my prayer. Because when he was beating me, I wonder, does this man beat me? Are you sure, man? You know? And my father would justify, he says, he was speaking in Yoruba language. He says, in the heart of a child is the devil.
Yeah.
It's the Lord that will correct us, that will bring you back. Listen, gentlemen. We have a responsibility to let our children know they're not ordinary children.
Amen.
Amen.
Parents of Moses looked at Moses and said, we knew this one is not an ordinary child. This one is not meant to just die.
Yeah.
It's not meant to waste it. It's a special child. Because children are the heritage of the Lord.
Yes.
God, in our days, is looking for godly offspring.
Amen.
Malachi chapter 3, 2, verse 14.
Yeah.
One thing that God is looking for in a marriage is godly offspring. All the kissing, all the honeymoon, all the makeup, all of that is for you and your husband to enjoy. The only thing that God is interested in is the children. Because there is heritage. God is looking for godly offspring. And the godly offspring, the tomorrow's leaders are seated with us.
That's right.
They're the future. They're great. A great army is rising up. I know society, I'm a father, but there's a responsibility that comes with it.
That's right.
Our responsibility is to instill greatness in them, to teach them who God is and who they are in God. Now the dream. His brothers hated him for his dream. Because he had, the Bible says that he reported his brothers to his father.
Yes.
He didn't because of that. They hated him. They were jealous because his father gave him a goat. But they hated him because of his dream. He said, let us kill him and let's see whether this dream will come true.
You know the funny thing about that story?
You would have thought that Jesus Christ would come from the line of Joseph.
Yeah.
But he did not.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ came from the line of Judah.
Yes.
You know what Judah did? Yes. Judah was the one that said, let's sell him to the Midianites.
Yeah.
So they saw in him that this man is going to shine above us, so they wanted to get rid of him. Not knowing that, hold on, this is our season. At this time, Joseph will be the one that will outshine everyone, only for us to be able to shine too tomorrow. Do you understand? God was, Joseph was not the only star. He said, I saw the star, the moon, bowing down to me, but there were stars too, to shine. That's why you see, when we are ignorant, that's why we are jealous of one another. You don't know that in music, the melody that he's speaking is bringing the presence of God to some.
That's right.
Not love Joseph alone. God loved the patriarchs. All of them.
Yeah.
All of them were special before God. Mm. Jesus Christ came from the line of Judah. And this Judah picked up his brother and sold him to slavery.
That's right.
He was betrayed. Listen to me. Joseph was sent by his father to go and take this food to his brothers. He got to a place he didn't see them. He could have gone back. Dad, I didn't see them. You know, they are very playful. They must have gone, here is the food. But he did not. He loved his father. He loved his brother. Knowing that this is their food. Can you imagine? He was bringing the food to them. I said, my brothers. And they thinking, let's kill him. You can imagine the shock. He got there, he stood off, and he put him in the pit, and he waited the food. Imagine the kind of talk that would be going through his head. Are this a joke? I know this is a prank. You guys have gone too far. Are you serious? Ruben, are you going to be? Judah, okay. Thank you, Judah. Judah, and you came out. I need you guys to play. All of a sudden, they sold him to the media.
Yeah.
I'm off. Before you knew it, reality will be done on him when Potiphar now bought him. I know the way they buy the slaves in those days. They check them out. They're stark naked. Sorry, ladies, they play with their balls to see how strong they are. Check their muscles. This one is strong, healthy. Oh, yeah. That will determine their price. It was sold. I think it was 20 shekels. Was it 30 or 20? I can't remember. He was put in prison. Even when he was in Potiphar's house, he prospered. Yet, for an offense, he did not commit. You know, when Potiphar's wife approached him, ladies and gentlemen, if it was you and I that we approached like that, would we not say God works in mysterious ways? How many of us would do what Joseph did?
Yeah.
Let's not deceive ourselves. I won't signify by this up your hand. You know, we are all holding that, you know, especially you people that are wearing this gong gown. Without any shadow of doubt, I doubt if anybody here will honestly not, will not consider this the way of God. That God works in mysterious ways. This is the way God, that's the interpretation of my dream. This is where God wants to promote you. Rather than be defiled, he said, I will not do this. He didn't say, I've sinned against my boss. He said, I've sinned against God. But guess what happened to him? The main thing that happened to him, he was put in prison. Now, what do you think he would have said? God, what's this now? If I had gone and taken that invitation, I wouldn't be here. I did it because of you. See how where he landed me. At that point in time, do you think he was happy with God? Do you think he was pleasing with God? He was saying, praise God, hallelujah, praise God, hallelujah. I think I'm not what I'm saying. And now see, because he's human like you. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Even in prison, he cheered himself up. He was a self-motivated person.
Yeah.
He even helped interpret two dreams. And he said, don't forget me. Thinking and hoping that this copier will come and rescue me. Yeah. 1 month, yeah? 2 months. Ah, this is a joke. 3 months. 2 years after, the man has forgotten him completely.
Yeah, that's right.
Betrayed by his brother, put in prison for what he don't do, forgotten by the person he helped.
Yeah.
But despite all this,
yeah.
Joseph did not sit down in self-pity. Joseph did not live in depression.
Yeah.
Yes.
And God had not finished with him. All that experience, ladies and gentlemen, was God taking him through a school so that he'll be able to stand and be displayed by God. There's a school, there's a price you and I have to pay. In Joseph's case, he had to go to Potiphar's house. In Joseph's case, he had to go to prison. In Joseph's case, that's what he had to go through. But one day came that he had to arise from all that and become the prime minister of the land. It just didn't happen that he had a dream and next minute he became prime minister. It doesn't happen like that. You and I, we may be going through one thing or the other. We may find ourselves in prison right now.
That's right.
We may find ourselves in circumstances that we are not happy right now. Circumstances that don't look like our dream. Circumstances that don't look like what our capacity. Yeah. We may be walking like an elephant, eating like a rat. That's not the end of the journey.
Amen.
That's a process so that you are humbled before God and before man.
Amen.
That is a time for character formation. That's a time when you have to now realize that in you are nothing.
Yeah.
That you depend and you are not trying to depend on God because you are standing from your high, you have put yourself in the low, and in the low, there's nothing you can do. You've done all you can do, and there's nothing that's happening to you. But then, when you have finished everything you have done, God says, now is my turn.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen. Waited for 2 years. But this man that he helped and restored, I was able to help him out, did not help him, giving up hope. And then one day, unexpectedly, he gave himself open. I said, oh yeah, Oga, you need to shave.
Yeah.
You need to shave. Let's change your clothes. You're not going before Potiphar anymore. You're not going before Pharaoh.
Yeah.
At that point in time, Joseph and his gentleman was a changed man.
Yeah, that's right.
Took care of the household. Took care of the prison. He interpreted the dreams of other people. He interpreted the whole Pharaoh's dream. He gave solution to an impending problem, and that was meant to be a problem. Ladies and gentlemen, this is what you and I are meant to do. While we are waiting to get to our place of prominence,
yes,
in our journey, wherever we find ourselves, we are meant to shine there. In that workplace, you are meant to be the best staff. You are meant to be the best students. What do I mean by the best students? If the lecture starts at 9, don't come in past 9.
Yeah.
Come in before 9. Be seated there.
Amen.
If you're meant to start work at 8 o'clock, don't get there and say it's the traffic. We both said it doesn't work. It's not true. It's because you slept late. It's because you did not plan your time on time. Because traffic will always be there.
Yeah.
So get in your mind, work starts at 8. Program for you, work starts at 7:30. So you leave your home early, you get to work. You can say, what am I going to do? I say 30 minutes. Use that to sleep.
Yeah.
Use that to read your Bible.
Yeah.
Use that to prepare yourself for the day. Yeah. Be there early. Leave late if you have to.
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, let me give you a testimony concerning my life.
Yeah.
There was a time I was working in a place as a temporary staff, as a finance manager. Praise God. I suffered before I got there. But anyway, that's what the story is. The chief executive, new chief executive came to take over on the day I was made permanent. But I knew that because of the years, when she was a lady, she liked me. She took a special interest in me. And I didn't know why. Everybody was frightened of her, but she just took a likeness in me. I was the only one I could talk to her anyhow, for no reason. When she now said to me, you know what? That was before my appointment, I came to inspect the place. Nobody knew that I was the one that was going to take over. And I saw you walking away in the office. I said, and I asked, who is this young man walking away? And they said, it's a tempest. He said, he looked at me. He said, he stood there looking at me, walking away. I didn't even notice if she was there. And she walked away. He says, from that day, she took note of me. Are you with me? Let us activate, let us embark the culture of hard working, the culture of being diligent. Whatever you're asked to do, do it well. In the church of God, whatever you're asked to do, do it well. Do it to the best of your ability. Even if you don't get it right, at least you have done your best.
That's right.
Let's raise our children to always do their best.
Yeah.
And if their best does not give them force, that's fine. Encourage them.
Yeah.
Equip them.
Yeah.
But always demand the best of yourself and the best of others.
Amen.
Because those are the qualities that God wants from you and I. God gave us his best.
Eight lessons, quickly. Eight lessons that we can draw from the life of Joseph. I know your pastor is a very quiet preacher. The man talks, speaks good English, yeah, and all that. But some of us, we sweat. So we need handkerchief, you know? Just in case you didn't get the hint. Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, Joseph believed God. He held him to his dreams. How do I know this? Because when he was in prison, and someone said, two people said they had a dream. Says, interpretation comes from God. Tell me your dream.
Yeah.
And I will get you an interpretation to your dream. So if you can interpret other people's dream, don't you think you will have an idea at the very least of the dream that God gave him? He must have believed that God, who showed him that dream, was taking him somewhere. He believed God. He didn't know he was going to be prime minister of Egypt, but he knew he was going to be in a place of leadership. He was going to be in a place of prominence, but just didn't know how God would do it. He walked in integrity, even at a low state. Ladies and gentlemen, no matter how bad things may be for you and I, no matter how low things may be, you may come from a very prominent family in Nigeria or Africa or Sierra Leone, and you find yourself cleaning the toilet. You have done that. My wife and I used to clean toilets all day. They fired her. I was self-promoted supervisor.
Did you fire her?
I would have gone back.
Ladies and gentlemen, you might find yourself cleaning the toilet. You might find yourself stripping. You might find yourself, and you think, why am I doing this? I'm more than this. It's a temporary thing. It's what? It's what?
Temporary.
It's temporary. In that job, there's still dignity in labor.
That's right.
They see what? Dignity in labor. Can you imagine if the road sweepers don't sweep the road and the people that carry the garbage don't carry the garbage? Do you imagine how London would be? There was, or wherever you find yourself, please recognize that it's still dignity. Do it with dignity. Do it with pride. Knowing that you are not defined by what you do, you are defined by who you are and who owns you.
It was a blessing to others. Despite the injustice that he was facing, he was still a blessing.
Yeah.
He was still a blessing. He was still a blessing. Despite they put him in prison for something he did not do, but yet he was still helping to others. His job was to take care of the prison. His job was not to be a counselor to the school that had a dream. That was not his job.
Yeah.
He chose to do that. He chose to be a blessing. Wherever you find yourself in life, be a blessing. I have an habit that, and I thank God for it. I have good habits, unfortunately, you don't believe it, but I have some bad habits too. But God is delivering me one by one. It takes a process. Ask my wife, she will tell you a catalog of it, but don't believe everything. But anyway, that's another issue. Whenever I go to a gathering of God's people, I find something to do.
Yeah, that's right. From day one.
From day one.
Yeah.
If I see them, if I get up and they're packing the chairs, I'll just pack the chairs.
That's right, yeah.
Be a blessing. When I finish the service anywhere, especially here, or any church that I go to, I go and shake hands. Hello, how are you? How are you doing? How's everything?
That's right.
So I think, are you okay? What's the problem? Sit down, let's talk.
Yeah.
And as the person is telling me what the problem is, I'm saying, God, what should I do?
Yeah, that's right.
What should I do? And guess what? Guess what? God always comes through. Yes. Just avail yourself. The Bible tells us that we should not worry about what to say.
Yeah.
The Spirit of God will speak through us.
Yeah.
Just avail yourself.
Yeah.
I tell people I don't struggle to preach.
Yeah.
Why? Because when they say come and preach, I say okay. Then I go to God. God, they say come and preach. What do you want to tell them?
Yeah.
Then I'm your messenger. You tell me and I'll tell them.
Yeah, that's right.
Just make sure I hear properly.
Mm.
I never place myself in a position of knowing everything. I know nothing.
That's right.
So I submit myself to just speak to me. Whatever you say to me, I will say.
Mm.
Do you understand what I'm trying to say? Now, my struggle in that sense is only just to wait before God.
Yes.
Not to try to, I know. It's just prepare. Mine is to prepare whatever you have said to me. And if you are sending it to me, I'll not go and catch the scripture.
Mm.
I'll not go and send it. Okay. All right, thank you. Then I'll still go on his knees and I'll still pray. God, make sure I deliver it right.
Mm.
Are you with me?
Amen.
Be a blessing.
Amen.
Be a blessing. Be a blessing.
Amen.
Be a blessing.
Amen.
Be a blessing.
Amen.
You're coming to church. Don't just come and say, I'm coming to receive. Come and give too. Leave before you leave your house. Pray.
Yes.
Come with a song. Come with a word. That's why Colin is coming next week, Sunday, to share.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Woo.
Amen.
And guess what? I'll be calling you one by one.
Amen.
Some of us need to be kicked and pushed.
Yeah.
My former church, I was attending when I met my good friend. Oh, by the way, my friend sponsored me. Thought I was fake. This man. Well, anyway, that's another story. I was in my office, and my pastor called me. They want someone to come and preach in Italy.
Yeah.
Are you available? I said yes, sir. What date? Can you imagine? Yes, sir. What date? He gave me this, I quickly blocked it in my diary. I had no clue. I never had that experience before.
Yeah.
And I feel nervous. Of course I feel nervous.
Yeah.
Do I know what I was going to say? Of course I don't know what I was going to say. But the opportunity came, I just said yes.
Yeah.
When it comes to the thing of God, I have only one answer. Yes.
Yes,
Lord. That's the only one answer I have.
Yeah.
And I've seen in my life that God has always done his own business.
Mm.
God is just looking for you and I to avail ourselves.
Mm.
And at every point in time, watch this, Joseph made it known that God was the source of his gift.
Yeah.
When he was talking to the cupbearer and the baker, he says, God is the one that interprets dreams. When he was before Pharaoh, he said, God is the one that has interpretation of dreams. Don't think it's me. But tell me the dreams and God will give you an answer because I have access to God. That's our attitude, ladies and gentlemen. Never deny the source. Never deny that it's not you. And it's nothing that you and I have that God has not given to us. Even if it's your job, even if it's your beauty, even if it's your no hair, whatever it is, God gave it to you. Are you with me? Take it to pride and use it to his glory. Joseph never promoted himself. When he was before Pharaoh, this is the most powerful man on the land. He said, this is the interpretation of your dream. This is what you need to do. Get someone and put that person in charge.
That's right.
He said, people are qualified. I can do this thing. He didn't say that. God had taken him through the school. He had that depended on God. He now knew that promotion does not come from man, but from God.
Yes.
He now knew that the source of his strength is God. And that there was God that gave him that dream, and it was that same God that will help him fulfill that dream. You and I, even sadly, ladies and gentlemen, so many Christians, sadly, as I say, have too much selfish ambition.
Mm.
We don't mind stepping on anybody's toe just to get ahead. We see Christianity as competition, not complimenting one another.
Mm.
We backbite because we want to pull somebody down.
Mm.
We have a crab mentality.
Mm.
Then when you put a cramp in a pocket, you don't have to put a lid on it. Anytime someone wants to get that up, you don't have to pull it down.
Mm.
Sadly, we have that even among the tongue-believing Christians.
Mm.
But not us anymore.
Amen.
We will not backbite anymore.
Amen.
We will not gossip anymore.
Amen.
We will not start picking up the phone and be talking about other people. We will be lifted up other people. We will be promoted to other people. We will be cheerleaders and cheering whatever the men's version is of other people's gift. We will celebrate one another because we know that God in you, God in me. Brings the glory down.
Amen.
He did not promote himself. He acknowledged God in his blessing. God blessed him. Well, God was blessing him. He had two children, one Manasseh. God has helped me to forget my pains, my father's household, the things that they have done. God has helped me to forget them. Yeah. Everything. God has prospered me in the land that I suffered. Ladies and gentlemen, where you have suffered, God wants to bless you.
Amen.
Where that place that you have suffered, that place that you have suffered, that household that you have suffered, God wants to bless you.
Amen.
That's where God takes his glory.
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, when we say, God, glorify yourself in my life, listen very carefully. When Jesus Christ said, glorify yourself, you know what he meant? The answer to that glorification was to die on the cross.
Mm-hmm.
When Jesus Christ said, now glorify yourself, God said, I glorify my name, mm-hmm. and I will glorify it. How did he glorify it? By dying on the cross. But he didn't say dead on the cross, did he?
No.
He resurrected from the cross. But he still had to go through that experience. And if we are going through that experience, then ladies and gentlemen, he acknowledged God and he sought the blessing of God to compensate him. And he refused, that's the last point, to be bitter. He refused to be bitter by forgiving everyone. Starting with Potiphar's wife. Who forget, now he was the prime minister. He had now become Potiphar's boss.
Mm-hmm.
They could have said, let us reopen that case. Now come and vindicate, let me vindicate myself now. Oh yeah, Potiphar's wife, I come and explain how. He didn't do that. Are you with me?
Yeah.
And his brothers came. It was still painful. He cried. He has emotions like you and I. But he said, what you meant for evil, God. God allowed all this to happen so that through me, he can preserve. He saw it and had another perception to it. God may have turned it for ego, for good, but his brothers did not. They were doing evil.
Yeah.
But he didn't see it from their perspective. He chose to see from God's perspective. He never talked about the copyright. You forgot me for 2 years. Hey, you, it's all I did for you. He didn't say that. He forgave. He removed bitterness. That's why his light was able to shine. That's why the whole world came to him, because there was no bitterness in him. Darkness and light cannot coexist. Our light is meant to shine, and there's meant to be no room for darkness. We need to forgive. We cannot be the light of the world and be holding bitterness. We cannot be the light of the world and holding unforgiveness in our hearts. We need to work on it. We need to work on it, ladies and gentlemen. We need to work on it. Because it is time for us to shine. God wants you and I to shine. That's God's plan. And it's time. I believe every one of us will shine this year. No matter where we are. When he was in Potiphar's house, the Bible says, and the Lord was in Potiphar. And we were just a brother. When he was in prison, and the Lord was in prison. So wherever we are in our journey, are you with me? The Lord is with us.
Yes.
So there's nothing stopping us from shining.
Yes.
But let us examine ourselves and recognize there's nothing in us that is hindering the light of God to shine.
Yes.
And the key area that I believe affects us the most, ladies and gentlemen, is the fact that unforgiveness is bitterness.
Yes.
Let's rest on it.